Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the CG campus. My name is David Welch. I'm the CG Chair of Global Security at the Balsillie School of International Affairs, as well as the director. I'd like to welcome you tonight to the signature lecture series presentation titled Empathy or Death: Applying the Lessons of the Cuban Missile Crisis in the 21st Century. I'd like to begin by thanking CG's public event sponsors, 570 News and Wordsworth Books, for their continuing support. And I'd like to acknowledge the Balsillie School of International Affairs as a co-sponsor for tonight's event. In addition to the audience here, we also have a global audience watching on the live webcast. Here in the CG auditorium, you have question cards that we ask you to fill out and pass to the end of the aisle at 7:30, and again, if you wish, at 8 p.m. You will see CG volunteers walk down the two aisles to collect these questions. And for those of you who are watching online via the webcast feature, you can submit questions through the live chat function on your screen, and we'll submit those questions to the panel as well. You can also follow tonight's discussion on Twitter through the hashtags CGLive and Cuba50Talks. I'd like to acknowledge two special guests in our audience tonight, the Honorable Walter McLean, former MP and Secretary of State for Canada, and Mark Garrison, former director of the Watson Institute for International Studies at Brown University, as well as Deputy Chief of Mission at the U.S. Embassy in Moscow. As I'm sure many of you know, starting last week, we began to observe the 50th anniversary of the Cuban Missile Crisis, the closest the world has ever come to nuclear Armageddon. We are here today to take note of what the Cuban Missile Crisis can teach us about avoiding nuclear war. And in particular, over the course of the next couple of hours, we'll focus on the role of personalities and personal interactions. We're very pleased to have with us here this evening two eminently qualified scholars to address these issues: Professor Philip Brenner of American University in Washington, and Kingston Reef, Director of Nuclear Nonproliferation at the Center for Arms Control and Nonproliferation in Washington, D.C. Moderating this evening's discussion is Janet Lang, Research Professor at the Balsillie School of International Affairs. Janet and her husband, Jim Blight, the CG Chair in Foreign Policy Development at the Balsillie School, are award-winning authors and inventors of the method of critical oral history, which has revolutionized our understanding not only of the Cuban Missile Crisis, but of other seminal events and episodes during the Cold War and after. Recognized as two of the world's leading specialists on American foreign policy during the Cold War, Jim and Janet were also deeply involved in the making of two relatively recent award-winning documentary films: The Fog of War, 11 Lessons from the Life of Robert S. McNamara, and Virtual JFK, Vietnam If Kennedy Had Lived. They're also co-authors of several fascinating, important publications, including most recently, The Armageddon Letters, which is available for purchase tonight in the lobby after the lecture, and is part of a larger transmedia project led by Jim and Janet in conjunction with Koji Masutani, who was the director of Virtual JFK. Jim, Janet, and Koji have really put the Balsillie School and the CG campus on the map as hub for the not only the recognition, but the reflection on the importance of the Cuban Missile Crisis and our brush with nuclear disaster 50 years ago. Jim and Janet have been very busy this past week or so, giving presentations on their research findings, talking to local and national and international media on the subject, proof that the Cuban Missile Crisis still holds a very powerful place in the minds of many. In fact, W5 on CTV recently aired an interview between Jim and Lloyd Robertson, which you can find on the CTV W5 webpage, Two nights ago, PBS aired a documentary on the missile crisis, Three Men Go to War, which also featured Jim. Not least, Jim and Janet are my guests in this week's episode of Inside the Issues, a CG online podcast. Jim will join us a bit later tonight. Just at the moment, he's being held hostage by the New York Times comment page editor. Look for Jim and Janet's op-ed in the Times tomorrow morning. Tonight's lecture is part two of the official publication launch of the Armageddon Letters, a book that Jim and Janet will happily sign for you after the presentation today in the lobby, if you wish. I'd also like to invite you to visit the website www.armageddonletters.com for a truly remarkable set of transmedia resources that graphically convey how close the world came to nuclear catastrophe in 1962. And with that, let me please welcome Janet Lang to the podium to introduce tonight's speakers.
Thanks, Dave. That was a wonderful introduction. It's a good thing it's dark over there because I was blushing like crazy. It's really a big pleasure for us to be here. And as Dave mentioned, Jim really is sorry that he can't be here. He'd much rather be here interacting with you than waiting for emails and calls to come from the New York Times for this query and that query and whatever. And in principle, cross those fingers, we get to lock up our op-ed piece by 8:30 tonight, and with luck it will get printed tomorrow, but New York Times is New York Times, no guarantees, one never knows what will happen, so we'll see. But in the meantime, I get the extraordinary honor and pleasure to introduce these two people to you. They are very, very special people. I think they're special people nationally, internationally, and they're also special people personally to Jim and to me. Jim and I have been thinking about this 50th anniversary commemoration of the missile crisis, the closest we ever came to nuclear war, why it mattered obviously then, but more importantly, why it matters now. We've been thinking about this for at least the anniversary for at least 3 years. We've been thinking about the crisis for decades. And as we thought about sort of how to orchestrate what we wanted to do here at our home turf, we thought about a sort of two-part kind of thing where we, Jim and I, would do what we did last night, try to create a time machine and bring you back to 62. But really, again, the kicker is 2012 and beyond. And frankly, to get to the bottom line at the top, we couldn't think of better people to share with this community where we live and appreciate living, two better people to help us do that than Phil Brenner and Kingston Reef. So I want to tell you just a little bit about them. Some of it is sort of your basic kind of thing that you can get when you Google them, but then there'll be just a little bit more. So Phil Brenner, distinguished Professor Phil Brenner. Phil is a senior professor at the in U.S. foreign policy at the School of International Service at American University in Washington, D.C. Phil has been engaged since 1974 in research and writing about Cuba and the U.S. His most recent book is A Contemporary Cuba Reader, Inventing the Revolution. Also, in 2002, he and Jim worked on a book called Sad and Luminous Days, Cuba's Struggle with the Superpowers After the Missile Crisis. And this explores the Cuban Missile Crisis from the Cuban perspective, something that we tried to do very much last night and share with you. And it also explores a secret speech that Castro delivered to the Cuban leadership in 1968. 6 years after the crisis. But it's an extraordinary speech. And you can see when you read the speech, and especially when you read the interviews and the descriptions and the analysis that Jim and Phil did on it, that 6 years later, it was like the missile crisis happened yesterday. in Cuba and what that meant for the continuing kind of lessons that they drew from it. It's a remarkably wonderful book. And I actually apologize that we didn't think ahead and have that book here for you to possibly consider buying. Since 1985, Phil Brenner has also served on the advisory board of the National Security Archive, which is our sister research institute. All of the work that we do, the critical oral history that Dave talks about, has an important component of the documents of the time. Very, very important. And the National Security Archive, a nonpartisan independent group in Washington, D.C., has been critical partner in helping us to uncover the documents from all sides of the U.S. foreign policy disasters that we investigate. Phil is on the advisory board of the archive, and he's been involved in the archive's efforts to declassify and disseminate documents about U.S. foreign policy. Philip Brenner has sued the U.S. government many times and won, all to the good. So that's the sort of official story on Phil. A teeny little bit of a background story for Phil is that we met Phil on January 11th, 1989 in Washington, D.C. Actually, Dave met Phil on January 11th, 1989 in Washington, D.C. Jim and Dave were at the National Press Club doing an event for the book called On the Brink, one of the early books that came out on our missile crisis research. And after the event, the director then of the National Security Archive, Scott Armstrong, came up to us and introduced a colleague that he brought, Phil Brenner, and he said, you know, you guys are going to be having a meeting in Moscow soon, continuing our work on the missile crisis, trying to get the Soviet side, but you know, for the first time, Cubans are going to be there. Don't you think you really need a Cuban expert there as well to help you in this terra incognito? And we said, yes, we do indeed. Introduced us to Phil, and this was the beginning of Phil's tutoring and mentoring us in the quest to understand the Cuban Missile Crisis. So it is really an enormous pleasure for me to now be able to introduce Phil to you, who's going to, again, remind us about the Cuban Missile Crisis, but because he's so steeped in that, can really feel and understand and convey to you the implications of the Cuban Missile Crisis for 2012 and beyond. Philip Brenner.
Wow, wouldn't everyone love an introduction like that? I almost didn't get up. I didn't realize it was me she was talking about. Thank you very much for that introduction. I want to thank the Basili School for inviting me, the Center for International Governance Innovation. This is a great institution and has acquired a worldwide reputation, I think deservedly so. David Welch, who I've known since January 11th, 1989. And I must say that tutoring goes certainly in both directions, if not more coming from them. If those of you who know Jim and Janet know what wonderful teachers they are and how generous they are. And so they share their knowledge not just with students, but with colleagues and really with the world. It's fabulous. You know, today, 50 years ago, on October 25th, a Soviet tanker came to what the United States called the quarantine line. The quarantine line was a blockade line. It was called a quarantine line to make it sound less threatening, more medicinal. It's what you do when you take your pet overseas. Put your pet in quarantine for a few days to make sure it's not carrying any diseases. But a blockade is an act of war, and that's what the United States was engaged in. And this was a moment of very high tension. The tanker came, the United States Navy stopped it, but didn't board it and let it continue through. The day before, yesterday, The United States went to defense condition 2. DEFCON 2 is the highest state of alert short of nuclear war. DEFCON 1 is nuclear war. I talked to a pilot who was flying his B-52 with hydrogen bombs in its bay, flying at fail-safe point, the point beyond which you can't call a plane back. He was hovering over the Mediterranean Sea, over Italy, over the Mediterranean Sea, over flying in a circle 24 hours a day, waiting to get the order to obliterate two Soviet cities. We were at a hair trigger 50 years ago today. A hair trigger. It's the closest we ever came to blowing up the world. We don't say that casually. The Armageddon letters is a proper name for those letters. This was very serious. I said to a group of students this afternoon here that I imagined what it must be like for them to try to see us talk, those of us who remember it, and I see there are a few of us in the audience who remember it actually when it happened, and we're talking about it as if it's something important. And when I was in graduate school, and their age, 50 years prior to that was World War I. And I thought to myself, if a professor had gotten up there excited about talking about World War I, I would have thought, man, he's a loony. I mean, who would have, and I teach a course on the missile crisis, a whole course on World War I. But in fact, this does deserve the attention because it was the closest we ever came. And as a result, it's also the most studied crisis in the history of the world. We want to learn from our successes as well as learning from our mistakes. And so there have been endless studies. When Jim and Janet first began to do work on the missile crisis, when they were at Harvard, Graham Allison, who was the grandfather, we should, the father, the most renowned Cuban missile crisis expert at the time, said, well, there's nothing new to learn. Why would you want to study the Cuban Missile Crisis? He had written the classic work on it called Essence of Decision. And it turned out that he was wrong. And since then, there have been numerous studies. And even as recently as last week, we're still learning a lot of new things. So we study this crisis partly to learn about how to do it right in some sense. Because after all, the world didn't end, came close but didn't end. The United States got what it wanted, the missiles out of Cuba. These were ballistic missiles, understand? These were missiles that could leave Cuba, hit a city on the east coast of the United States, 5 to 8 minutes later. They carried warheads that were 60 times bigger than the bomb that obliterated Hiroshima, 60 times more powerful. And they were aimed at Washington, New Orleans, Atlanta, port cities along the East Coast. So the lesson that we want to learn from this is we got what we wanted, the missiles out. Only one US soldier died, and we didn't go to war. And those lessons are still applied today. The single most important lesson, I think, that comes out of the missile crisis is this, that you can back your adversary down if you just apply a little more pressure, just a little more threat, just inch by inch, you can calibrate. This is how Arthur Schlesinger described it, that this crisis was matchlessly calibrated, brilliantly managed. That's wrong. It wasn't true. That's a fiction. Yet it's a lesson we apply today, for example, in Iran. What has President Obama been doing about Iran? He's slowly, and with other countries, Canada, I would note as well, They're tightening the screws, as we say. You know, that's a horrible metaphor. Tightening screws is a metaphor for torture, right? That's what you do. You tighten the screw on someone's thumb till they scream just a little, or on their temples just a little harder till they scream a little louder and finally give in. So we're talking about torture. That's what tightening the screws means. That's what we think is going to get us what we want. And that lesson comes directly from the missile crisis. And it's based on the idea that we came eyeball to eyeball with the Soviets, and they blinked. The Soviets blinked. So why is that wrong? Well, most importantly, what was not told at the time, we didn't find out until 1987 at a conference that Jim and Janet organized, we didn't learn that Kennedy actually had compromised. A very important point of information. He was flexible. He wasn't backing Khrushchev. He wasn't standing there with a steel will. He was trying to find a way out of this crisis without a war. That's not the lesson we got out of the missile crisis. The lesson we got avoided telling anyone that there was a trade of missiles in Turkey for the missiles in Cuba. That little secret, that dirty little secret, would have changed a whole understanding of the crisis. And we know that there were daily communications between them, cables, trying to figure out how to get out of this crisis. There was bluster at the beginning, yes, toughness, but very soon, both of those leaders were looking for a way out. And ultimately, what ends the crisis isn't that Khrushchev was afraid that he was going to die. No, you know, in the White House, all the key officials, even down a little lower, were given slips of paper on Saturday, October 27th, to tell them where to go in a Maryland or Virginia mountainside safety bunker. They were going to live. Kennedy said, oh, the living would envy the dead in a nuclear war, but they were going to live. This is not the same kind of fear as Jim has written in a very early book on this called The Shattered Crystal Ball. This was not the same kind of fear you have. Well, Canadians don't even know. Americans know about this because you don't have crime in Canada. But in the United States, I come from Washington, D.C., and we have some crime. And so it's like you're in a dark alley and someone holds a gun to your head and says your money or your life, and we has some meaning for an American audience. And that's not the fear they felt. Khrushchev had a place to go also. No, they felt fear about holding humanity in their hands. The fear that they would destroy all of civilization. It's a different kind of fear. And it's really a very important way, to understand, to bring in that element to the missile crisis. So let's try to understand what, using some correct lessons, what the lessons should be for the 21st century that we should derive from the missile crisis. And to start, we need to understand that there were, in some ways, three missile crises. Three in the sense that the three countries involved had different stories that they told themselves and their citizens, the narrative that they learned, that children have repeatedly learned about the missile crisis. I dare say every school child, or at least high school student, college student, that if they know anything about history, they know the missile crisis and they know it incorrectly in the United States. The US calls the missile crisis the Cuban missile crisis. Dana Perino, George W. Bush's press secretary, was asked in 2003, as the United States was invading Iraq, if the Cuban missile crisis lessons figured into the invasion plans. And she said, some of you may remember this, frankly, I don't know what the Cuban missile crisis was, but I suppose it was about Cuba and missiles. And it was a lucky guess. That was right. In the United States, it was about missiles in Cuba, and it lasted 13 days, from October 16th to October 28th. The Soviets call it the Caribbean crisis. For them, the crisis occurred on the high seas at that quarantine line where the two superpowers actually came into confrontation. And for the Soviets, they didn't want to talk about the missiles. They wanted to talk about the United States confronting the Soviet Union and bringing them that close. So it was the Caribbean crisis. Cuba was left out of the Soviet crisis. For the Cubans, and the Soviet timeline is different. The Soviet timeline begins in October 1961, 12 months earlier. In 1960, President Kennedy had said there was a missile gap. The United States was behind, and the Soviets were ahead. It was believable because the Soviets were the first to put a satellite in space, Sputnik, first man to fly in space, Yuri Gagarin. And so it was believable in the campaign. On October 23rd, Roswell Gilpatrick, 1961, Roswell Gilpatrick, the Deputy Secretary of State of Defense, gave a speech where he announced that the missile gap was actually way in the US favor. We had 10 times the number of warheads and far more vehicles capable of delivering a strike against the Soviet Union. They had very few, and their missiles might not have landed where they wanted them to land. You could see a missile taking off and landing in Kiev or landing in Siberia or the Pacific Ocean. It wasn't a serious deterrent. They had no way of deterring us, they felt. And their reaction to Roswell Gilpatrick's speech was to, the next week, to explode in the atmosphere a 50 megaton bomb. A bomb that was 3,000 times more powerful than the bomb at Hiroshima. The largest bomb ever exploded in the atmosphere. You think, you're bad, we're tough, you can't push us around, but they were frightened. So they date it from then, when they began to worry about a US first strike, and it goes beyond in another 3 weeks after October 28th. The Cubans dated from April 17th, 1961, or April 20th, when the United States failed to overthrow the Cuban government at the Bay of Pigs, and Castro reasoned that Kennedy wouldn't accept a defeat, that Kennedy would do it again, and we did. We launched an attack against Cuba, the largest covert war we had until that point, something called Operation Mongoose. And Operation Mongoose involved terrorism, it involved an embargo, it involved political isolation, military intimidation, real terrorism, as we assassinated people in Cuba, gave out guns to guerrillas who terrorized villages, blew up factories, and so on. And they date it and in many ways that's what led to the missile crisis, their feeling the need to defend themselves, and they date it till after October 28th when they felt there was a crisis between them and the Soviet Union over removing other weapons. And in fact, the United States kept its strategic forces at DEFCON 2 until November 20th. So there's a reality to that. Listen to Che Guevara. In a farewell letter to Fidel Castro, Guevara writes, this farewell, he was leaving to go to the Congo and then Bolivia in 1965. I've lived magnificent days and I've felt at your side the pride of belonging to our people in the luminous and sad days of the Caribbean crisis. Called it Caribbean crisis, the Cubans call it the October crisis, I forgot to tell you. They said there were so many crises that they started giving them names by months. I think that's probably not true, but that was a way of distinguishing it from what the Soviets called it. Luminous and sad days. What crisis did he live through? I never heard an American, a Canadian, a Russian ever use those words to describe the missile crisis. Think of the words that normally get used to describe a crisis: harrowing, horrifying, stressful, relief that we didn't blow up the world, luminous and sad. What was luminous about this crisis? Well, for Che Guevara, it was the bonding, the extraordinary tension where everyone felt as one in a struggle against imperialism. Sad, the betrayal by the Soviet Union. Now, this is something we have to understand. How this is a crisis that ended with no Cubans dying. How could they feel? And the Soviets got a promise from Kennedy that the United States wouldn't invade Cuba. How can they feel betrayed? Well, in order to understand the lessons for the 21st century, we have to comprehend why Che Guevara called this sad, called it a betrayal. In fact, I say we dare not avoid comprehending this, because that is essential for us to survive the 21st century. So for those of you who haven't been lucky enough to study the Cuban Missile Crisis in high school or college or graduate school, let me just tell you very briefly that there have been two traditional ways to understand the crisis. One is at what might be called the level of realism, where it's the political scientists call this the state level of analysis, where you try to understand how states try to maximize their power, and you think about the missile crisis in terms of maximizing, of states maximizing power, a kind of chess game with the world. And so we look at the Soviet motivations and say, why did they, and this is what the Kennedy people did, why did they put the missiles in Cuba? Well, there are a lot of possibilities. Khrushchev's crazy. Well, okay, no, that's not a good enough point. He wants to defend Cuba. No, why would he do that? This is pretty risky, putting these missiles. The Soviet Union has never, never put ballistic missiles, missiles like this, in outside of the Soviet Union. So there had to be a good reason. And the one reason that they came up with and stayed with was Berlin. It was that Khrushchev was playing a grand chess game. He'd put missiles in Cuba, and then he'd be willing to bargain them away to get the United States and the Western allies out of West Berlin, and then he'd capture Berlin, the great, I don't know what the equivalent in chess would be, but a good piece, a queen, not quite a queen, a good piece in a chess game. You know, real strategic reason. It had become a symbol, but nonetheless, that was the aim. This is what really psychologists would describe as a common source of misperception in international relations, where you attribute to the other side your own way of thinking, your own motivations. In this case, the aggressive assertion of power. It turns out that is not why they put the missiles in Cuba. They didn't discuss the Berlin at all in the discussions about putting missiles in. Last week, a researcher who got much of her training from Jim and Janet, Svetlana Savranskaya, published a book about Anastas Mikoyan, who was the deputy premier of the Soviet Union. It was a book that was written by his son, Sergei Mikoyan, but the English version, which came out last week, is really Svetlana's work and brilliantly done. And what we see from the documents, because 2/3 of the book is documents as well as her narrative, what we see is that in all of the discussions about putting missiles in Cuba, the one concern the Soviets had was the defense of Cuba. Not Berlin, not even the strategic balance of missiles that I had suggested in talking about Roswell Gilpatrick. No, it was about the defense of Cuba. Sergo McCoyan, in writing about this, says, and I'll quote from, later analysts focused on the military balance. And Sergo says, it's impossible, though, to agree with John Gaddis's opinion, a famous diplomatic historian, in the part that the Cuban Missile Crisis occurred due to the fact that Khrushchev understood more clearly than Kennedy that the West was winning the Cold War. Gaddis does not have a grasp on all the psychological aspects of the Soviet leaders' ways of thinking. That issue had been decided approximately 15 years before the missile crisis. Even Stalin was reconciled with the fact that Western Europe and Japan had gone under the American sphere of influence. Were not the Marshall Plan, NATO, the occupation of Japan by US troops, and the military pact between the United States and Japan enough to have an understanding of the issues about the sphere of influence? Nobody in the Kremlin needed to wait until 1961 or 62 to realize what was obvious. But then he notes, well, once we decided to put missiles in there, most likely when trying to determine the number of missiles to be sent to Cuba, Marshal Malinovsky, the defense minister, was guided by some secondary ideas. I believe that the R-14, which were slightly longer range ballistic missiles, with their capacity to reach the entire continental United States, were not needed to prevent a strike on Cuba. It was too much. It was sufficient to deploy the R-12s, but the military people, he said, took advantage of the fact that they were putting missiles in, so they put more than Khrushchev wanted, and they put bigger ones than Khrushchev wanted. It would have been fine to put 20 medium-range missiles. The United States would have been deterred in Khrushchev's view, but the marshals, okay, they had their way. So there was an element of strategic balance from the marshals' thinking, but not in the initial decision. So here we understand from that first level of analysis, state level, we've gotten it wrong for many, many years. We did not understand why the Soviets put the missiles in Cuba. There was an article this week in the Washington Post by their intelligence reporter, Walter Pincus. And he said, you know, until recently, until documents actually came out last week, there was also a large cache of documents that was released by the Cold War International History Project, 800 pages of documents. And going through those, he said, we learned that Khrushchev was not intent on using nuclear missiles. The United States believed he was willing to, that he had an unsophisticated notion of nuclear missiles and that he would be willing to use nuclear missiles. But it turns out he wasn't at all. And Pincus asks, what do we know about the way in which the Iranians think about nuclear missiles? Are we making decisions based on real knowledge of how they think about nuclear missiles? And before we do these calculations, shouldn't we find that out? So at the level of the state analysis, the traditional way of thinking about international relations, I think we have a lot to learn still. The second level of analysis is the level of analysis that most students study. And it's the organizational level. This is the essence of decision. Graham Allison's famous novel. I say that correctly because it's a work of fiction. A book that describes a process that didn't happen. It describes the way in which a small group of people met and were able to come up with an idea to put a quarantine around and finally give it to Kennedy, and Kennedy says, this is a great idea, and he goes with it. And the lesson is that, well, there's what Allison calls organizational dynamics at work, but this is a good model. It's the model that you can, because we succeeded in the missile crisis, another lesson is you can manage crises if you do what Kennedy did. Namely, you have a small group that meets in utter secrecy, locks out other ideas, foreign influences, and you ultimately come up with a out-of-the-box solution. The reality is, we know now from a book that was published last month by Sheldon Stern, who had been the chief historian at the John F. Kennedy Library and has listened endlessly to the Kennedy tapes, a book called The Cuban Missile Crisis in American Memory, Myths Versus Reality, that this small group, the XCOM, actually was manipulated by Kennedy rather than giving Kennedy advice. It worked exactly the opposite way. The model of how to make decisions that we thought we had so brilliantly calibrated is not a model at all. It brings us down to the third level of analysis, the individual level. And it's at the individual level that we can begin to understand emotions and human feeling, human beings, the agents of these decisions. And two important human emotions that we need to deal with. One is fear, and the other is empathy. I've talked a little bit about fear already, and I won't anymore. Let me bring empathy to the forefront. And here I'm going to quote from an article by Janet Lang and Jim Bly. An article they published 2 years ago called When Empathy Failed, Using Critical Oral History to Reassess the Collapse of U.S.-Soviet Détente in the Carter-Brezhnev Years. Have you read that article? You don't remember it, though. Okay. Empathy, they write, has nothing to do with sympathy, with which it's often confused. Ralph White, a political scientist psychologist, was for an entire generation of political psychologists the foremost advocate of what he called realistic empathy. We quote him at length, they say, and here they're quoting White on empathy. Empathy, he says, is the great corrective for all forms of war-promoting misperception. It means simply understanding the thoughts and feelings of others. It's distinguished from sympathy, which is defined as feeling with others, as being in agreement with them. Empathy with opponents is therefore psychologically possible even when a conflict is so intense that sympathy is out of the question. We're not talking about warmth or approval, and certainly not about agreeing or siding with, but only a realistic understanding. And then he offers some important correctives. I prefer to list them as three essential steps for empathy. The first is putting yourself in someone else's shoes. These are the bumper stickers of empathy, if you will. When you're in someone else's shoes, seeing yourself as they see you, that's really the hard part, seeing yourself as they see you. And then there's the third element that has itself three components, three watchwords. The first is that you have to believe that your adversary wants peace. The second is that you have to recognize that your opponent has justified fears. And the third is that you have to acknowledge that your opponent may have a reasonable anger. And then I would add a fourth to this. I would say that it's essential that you accept the legitimacy that the other exists. Because if you don't start actually from there, there's no possibility of empathy. Think about Castro in the Cuban Missile Crisis. The United States was trying to overthrow the Cuban government. We had active assassination plans. This is now well known. We have the Inspector General's report on the CIA's attempt to assassinate Castro. We have the director of the Central Intelligence Agency testifying about this. We know the United States was actively trying to assassinate Castro. Jim and Janet invited the person in charge of the assassination program to two of their conferences. So there was misperception going on during the Cuban Missile Crisis that where the two superpowers would have benefited from maybe talking to each other. You know, a U-2 was shot down on October 27th by a Soviet officer who violated an order. Khrushchev had ordered not to shoot down any of the U-2 surveillance planes. And this officer shot one down in an emotional moment when he saw the plane coming over, he said, "I saw it on my radar screen and I pushed the button." Well, let's think about Castro. Was he misperceiving what the United States was doing? No, he believed the United States was trying to assassinate him. So what could Kennedy have done with a hotline? "Hello, Mr. Castro, we're trying to assassinate you, but don't take it personally." There was no misperception about this. He perceived exactly what the United States, correctly what the United States was trying to do. So the problem wasn't misperception in the first place. The problem was trying to get rid of them. And the, in some sense, this is the same problem with Iran. It leads me to finish up here, because I know Janet's going to get really angry soon. Oh, is there a note? What does that say, 15 minutes? What does it say?
Five,
okay, 5 minutes. So let me call this empathy and asymmetry. It's very difficult for a great power to empathize with a small power. Small powers exaggerate threats. Great powers tend to dismiss them as pinpricks, as nothing very significant at all. The Soviet Union and the United States found it easier to empathize with each other than either found themselves able to empathize with Cuba. At the 1989 conference that David and Jim and Janet helped to organize, Andrei Gromyko, the Soviet foreign minister, was describing the Cold War context. And he said, there was a lot of tension between the United States and Cuba. That tension could have broken out anywhere. It could have broken out, well, in Cuba, or it could have broken out in Berlin or somewhere else. It was like describing acne on a teenager's face. You never know where that pimple is going to come up. And the Cubans, to be sure, were very offended. The missile crisis was about Cuba, about the United States trying to overthrow Cuba. It couldn't have just happened anywhere. Gromyko couldn't see this Cuban point of view. Let me tell you, this might take me into 6 minutes. We were trying, at one moment, Jim and Janet were trying to get Henry Kissinger to go to Cuba to meet with Fidel Castro. 1993, Cold War is over. Let's see if we can find a way to end the Cold War between the United States and Cuba, and Kissinger going would be a good way to do it. We had a six-hour meeting with Kissinger, and part of it was eating, but part of it was sitting around talking to him about the history of his earlier efforts in 1974 and 75 to have a rapprochement when he was Secretary of State. And what he couldn't understand is he did an awful lot, and he did, to move towards breaking down the distrust on the part of Cuba. The U.S. sponsored a motion in the Organization of American States to end the embargo, the hemispheric embargo. He then allowed U.S. subsidiaries in third countries, a big champion of that was Litton Industries in Canada, to sell products to Cuba, essentially breaking the embargo. And what did Cuba do in return? It sent troops to Angola to essentially support the side we were opposing in a civil war. And so that was part of a Southern African strategy that was very important to us. Kissinger was very angry at that. "You slapped me in the face," essentially, when you did that, he was saying about Castro. And he couldn't understand why Castro would do it. And basically, his answer was Castro was a megalomaniac. And he would just, you know, or a child, or irrational. And I suggested to him that maybe Castro had gotten everything he thought he could get from you. He didn't really trust you. Why would anyone trust Henry Kissinger? So he got great gifts from you, and then he never thought he'd get more. He didn't believe these were steps towards a rapprochement with the United States with Henry Kissinger in charge. He would send troops to Angola, they would win the war, there would be a new administration in 1977. At that point, he'd be able to pull troops out, and he'd work with the next president. It was quite a rational step for him. And Kissinger said, you know, that makes an awful lot of sense. And then Kissinger wrote his memoirs of the period 1974-75, and he said, well, the reason Castro did this was because he's a megalomaniac and he's irrational. And in the end, he couldn't bring himself to actually empathize with Castro. He fell back on a standard formula. These third world leaders are irrational. It's much more comfortable, it felt, to call Castro that, or the Iranian leaders that, than to think that they might have real interests. So let's apply the empathy standards to Iran. Of course, I think we need a lot of time to do that. I'm gonna actually, the Kingston Reef, do some of this. If we apply the, and look at what we have done, we put ourselves in their shoes, we look at what the United States, what the United States has done to Iran. The United States overthrows their democratically elected government. Yes, then they take us, our embassy people hostage. But the group of students that took the embassy people hostage, they were called the Mossadegh Brigade, named after the democratically elected prime minister who we overthrew. And during the Iran-Iraq War, when many Iranians were killed, the United States provided chemical weapons to Iraq and then pinpointed the targets with U.S. intelligence and satellites for the Iraqis to hit Iranians. During this time, we shot down one of their airliners and barely even apologized, a civilian airliner. What have they done to us? So are they afraid of the United States? Do they have a reasonable fear? They are surrounded by U.S. military. They are on a list of countries, the axis of evil. They're considered a terrorist state. Do they have a justified fear of the United States? Do they want peace? Well, we claim they don't, but do we know? Do they have nuclear weapons as a defense or as an offense? Well, we, the United States, only use nuclear weapons as an offense, except we refuse to renounce a no first use policy, so we're willing to use. So if you apply the empathy test to them, it begins to look like maybe they're not so crazy. How are we gonna find out? Talk to them. That's how we'll find out. Talking is the great corrective ultimately, because talking is what leads to empathy. Talking is what leads to, it's at an individual level. The lesson of the missile crisis then ultimately is that you can't have models of decision making that will help you solve a crisis when you have nuclear weapons or weapons of mass destruction. All you have is ways of preventing crisis. And the best way to prevent a crisis is by applying empathy. We have two choices before us: talking and having empathy, or death. It's our choice. Thanks.
Thank you, Phil. Can you all hear me back there well enough? Yeah, okay, great. So let me first of all, in addition to thanking Phil, I want to encourage you and remind you to fill out your question cards there and begin passing them around so we can pick up at least the first round of them, and then questions. So if you could do that, we'd appreciate it, because I know the talk was very stimulating and provocative, and from past experience, I know that you guys are great and ask fabulous questions, so we're all looking forward to getting them. Okay, so let me turn to a brief introduction of Kingston Reef here. First of all, you'll notice, no offense, Phil, Kingston is of a different generation. This is important. You need to hear a multi-generational approach to both the history and the current implications of the missile crisis. So Kingston Reef, he is the director of the Nuclear Nonproliferation at the Center for Arms Control and Nonproliferation in Washington, D.C. He works on nuclear weapons, arms control, nonproliferation, preventing nuclear terrorism, missile defense, on and on, all of these very, very important topics. He's an expert also, doesn't look old enough, but trust me, he is an expert also on the legislative process. He works closely with the U.S. Congressional Action Committees on nuclear weapons policy, budget, and related issues. He also writes a monthly column for the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, and he edits the Nukes of Hazard blog, a really fun blog. Is that a cool title or what? And so I encourage you to go in there and contribute and respond to his provocative pieces in there. He's published pieces in lots and lots of places, Survival, Defense News, World Politics Review. He's been a commentator for the New York Times, Time Magazine, Global Security Wires, Fox News. He does range far and wide. U.S. News and World Report, and so on and on and on. Again, he doesn't look old enough, but he's done it. That's part of the official story. A teeny bit more. He was an international relations major at Brown University. He won a Marshall Scholarship, went to the UK. He got an MSc at the London School of Economics, and then did a year at St. Andrews, where he got another degree. Those you can get from his website. Now, a teeny bit of the backstory. Kingston was a student of Jim's and me. He took our senior seminar when he was a junior, precocious boy that he was. Then again took another senior seminar when he was a senior, a star as a student. But in addition to sort of his brilliance, there was always something else special about Kingston. Jim went to the University of Michigan. Kingston's from Wisconsin. This boy, as a student, on the class we had before the big Michigan-Wisconsin football game, he came in his Wisconsin t-shirt. I mean, brazen or what? You know, he was always there to confront us in just the right way. Other thing is that when he was a Marshall Scholar and he's in London and then decides to transfer to St. Andrews for a very interesting program, my God, the emails that we got from him about his adventures on the old course. Knew how to really sort of, again, push back to his professors, always in interesting and provocative ways. Kingston is what anybody who is a teacher treasures, a student who becomes your colleague. It's really just an enormous pleasure for us to have Kingston here and to get his views and interests on the missile crisis. Kingston.
Well, thank you so much, Janet, for that wonderfully kind introduction. And while I certainly am of a different generation than Phil and Janet, I'm pretty sure that Phil has far, far more hair than I do. So it may be difficult to tell that at first sight. But in any event, thank you very much, Janet. Thanks to you and Jim and the Balsillie School for organizing a fabulous series of events on this very important anniversary, and for asking me to participate. And thanks to Dr. Brenner for a fabulous set of remarks that he just gave. And I thought what I'd do was supplement his perspective by offering a few of my own thoughts on the Cuban Missile Crisis, its relevance today, and what it tells us about the nuclear threat. Now, as Janet just mentioned, my fascination with the Cuban Missile Crisis began in college. In 2003, during my junior year at Brown University, I enrolled in a seminar on the Cuban Missile Crisis and weapons of mass destruction. It was taught by Jim and Janet, as they were and presumably still are up here north of the border, affectionately known by their students and colleagues. Simply put, I was terrified by what I learned in Jim and Janet's seminar. And again, as Janet just alluded to, it wasn't that I was terrified about the fact that I quickly realized that Jim and Janet were fanatical fans of Michigan University's American football team, the Wolverines. As a native of the neighboring state of Wisconsin, I was, and still am, a passionate supporter of the Wisconsin Badgers. No, what terrified me was the revelation that even though John F. Kennedy, Nikita Khrushchev, and Fidel Castro did not enter the crisis wanting a nuclear war, they almost unleashed one anyway. Despite the seemingly callous instability of nuclear deterrence during the Cold War, there were numerous moments during the Cuban Missile Crisis that could have resulted in nuclear Armageddon. For example, upon learning of the secret Soviet deployment, many of President John F. Kennedy's advisors recommended that he launch an air attack, an invasion of Cuba, to destroy the missile sites and overthrow once and for all Cuban leader Fidel Castro. Fearing the consequences of such an attack, Kennedy instead opted for a quarantine of Cuba to allow for a diplomatic solution. This show of restraint has important implications for contemporary US policy toward Iran, as I will discuss in more detail in a few moments. On October 27th, Dr. Brenner alluded to this, Soviet forces in Cuba shot down an American U-2 spy plane, but Kennedy again refused to use force. This strategy worked, but just barely. On October 28th, 1962, Khrushchev agreed to withdraw his arsenal of missiles and nuclear warheads from the island in exchange for Kennedy's public commitment not to invade Cuba and his secret concession to withdraw US Jupiter missiles from Turkey at a later date. Had the crisis lasted much longer, Kennedy likely would have given the orders to strike. What kind of world would we live in today had Kennedy attacked Cuba? Unbeknownst to the president, 43,000 Soviet troops and 98 Soviet tactical nuclear weapons were already on the island at the time of the crisis. It's hard to see how an attack wouldn't have resulted in the use of nuclear weapons against the US invasion force, prompting an escalatory spiral to all-out nuclear war. While Kennedy and Khrushchev's crisis management helped avert disaster, luck played an equally significant role. On October 27th, the most dangerous day of the crisis, Soviet troops in Cuba targeted the US military base at Guantanamo Bay with tactical nuclear weapons, and as we've already alluded to, shot down a U-2 spy plane. Another U-2 got lost over the Soviet Union, prompting Moscow to send fighters to shoot it down. In response, the US dispatched fighters armed with tactical nuclear weapons. In the Caribbean, a Soviet submarine captain almost fired his submarine's nuclear tip torpedo at a US warship. However, authorization to fire was denied by one of the officers on board. It was what Kennedy and Khrushchev did not know and could not control that made the crisis doubly perilous. What prompted the crisis, though, in the first place? And we heard some of this from Dr. Brenner. While Kennedy and Khrushchev exhibited just enough empathy at the end of the crisis to prevent disaster, it was the total absence of empathy in the lead up to the crisis that made crisis management necessary. Now, Michael Dobbs, who's a well-known scholar on the missile crisis, has written that by authorizing the Bay of Pigs invasion in 1961, followed by Operation Mongoose, Kennedy had given the Soviets every reason to believe that he was determined to get rid of Castro once and for all. To protect his Caribbean ally, Khrushchev made the reckless decision to deploy nuclear missiles right on America's doorstep. Now, if you believe former Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara, Kennedy had no intention of invading Cuba following the Bay of Pigs debacle, but he failed to appreciate how the Bay of Pigs and subsequent US actions were interpreted in Moscow and Havana. Castro, convinced a US invasion was imminent, repeatedly encouraged Cuban and Soviet troops to provoke a conflict with the United States, culminating in an October 27th letter to Khrushchev urging the Soviet leader to destroy America in a nuclear first strike. Nuclear weapons are unlike any weapons ever developed. One weapon could obliterate an entire city. A few dozen weapons could extinguish an entire country. Recent studies by climate scientists indicate that the use of 100 to to 200 weapons could destroy human civilization. At the height of the Cold War, there were some 70,000 nuclear weapons across the globe. Today, there are still approximately 19,000, most much more powerful than those that destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki in Japan in 1945. Over 95% of those weapons are in the hands of the United States and Russia. Supporters of maintaining the nuclear status quo argue that by deterring war, nuclear weapons keep us safe. But the Cuban Missile Crisis and other close calls during and after the Cold War provide clear evidence that deterrence is not foolproof. The use of nuclear weapons is possible even if no one desires such an outcome, especially during a crisis in which military forces are on high alert, accurate information is hard to get, and events on the ground cannot be controlled. Moreover, the crisis shows that nuclear use is unlikely to be premeditated, but rather the result of misperception, miscalculation, and risk-taking. Now, while many Americans believe that the nuclear threat disappeared with the Cold War, the risk that a conflict could lead to the use of nuclear weapons still exists. The threat of nuclear terrorism poses an additional harrowing danger. The Cuban Missile Crisis has taught us that the threat of nuclear calamity is only a few errors or misperceptions away, but the crisis is also instructive in other ways. Delaying disaster or making distasteful compromises may be preferable to outright war. Take Iran's nuclear program, for example. In a series of provocative articles this year, Harvard's Graham Allison, and we've had our fair share to say already about Graham Allison tonight, but I think on this point that I'm about to get into, he's correct, compares the US-Iran standoff to a Cuban missile crisis in slow motion. Now, Dr. Brenner has told us that, in fact, the Cuban missile crisis itself was a crisis in slow motion. But be that as it may, instead of choosing between attacking Iran's nuclear facilities or acquiescing to a nuclear-armed Iran, Allison argues that President Obama ought to follow in Kennedy's footsteps and explore alternatives that, however unacceptable, are less catastrophic. In a nutshell, Allison proposes Iran permanently and verifiably abandon enrichment beyond 5% in return for U.S. acceptance of Iran's continued enrichment up to that level. Another ominous lesson of the crisis relevant to Iran is that Castro's willingness to embrace apocalyptic martyrdom was driven by the fact that he was convinced that the U.S. was bent on invading Cuba and overthrowing his regime. After the disgrace of the Bay of Pigs, this probably was not Kennedy's intent, but can we really blame Castro for plausibly thinking otherwise? Fast forward to today, where one constantly reads of covert U.S. and Israeli efforts to sabotage the Iranian nuclear program and new sanctions to undermine the regime. While regime change is not the stated goal of the Obama administration's Iran policy, our intentions probably look quite a bit different from the seat of power in Tehran. As was the case during the lead-up to the missile crisis, both the United States and Iran are categorically failing to empathize with each other's security concerns. The consequences of this failure could be war and a nuclear-armed Iran. The only permanent exit ramp from the specter of nuclear annihilation is the abolition of nuclear weapons. Nuclear disarmament is daunting and not risk-free itself. The political, technical, and other obstacles and challenges to abolition have been well documented. Previous generations have at times awakened to the nuclear danger, which has prompted a meaningful sense of urgency about doing something about it. Such moments occurred in the immediate aftermath of World War II, after the Cuban Missile Crisis, and during and after the Reagan administration when the freeze movement developed. But these moments didn't last. In recent years, another wave of interest in nuclear disarmament has begun to develop. President Barack Obama devoted his first major foreign policy speech as president to the subject in April 2009 in Prague, where he pledged America's commitment to work toward a world free of nuclear weapons. In particular, the president laid out a series of interim steps that the United States must take to reduce the risk of nuclear catastrophe on the way to abolition. In articulating this vision, Obama was acting on a growing consensus most closely associated with Henry Kissinger, George Shultz, William Perry, and Sam Nunn who argued in a now famous 2007 Wall Street Journal op-ed that the nuclear status quo, defined by the potential spread of nuclear weapons to additional states, the threat of nuclear terrorism, and the continued existence of bloated nuclear weapons and material stockpiles, is simply not tenable. President Obama has made an early down payment on the vision he articulated in Prague. The steps that have been taken over the past 3 years, including the New START Treaty, which reduces the size of the US and Russian deployed nuclear arsenals, a new US nuclear policy review, and two nuclear security summits to raise awareness about and encourage action to prevent nuclear terrorism, are significant achievements. However, resistance from Russia, domestic political obstruction by Republicans, and the exigencies of an election year have combined to stymie next steps. In addition, Iran's nuclear aspirations and North Korea's intransigence continue to put significant pressure on the nonproliferation regime. In order to permit further progress, our elected officials, military leaders, and opinion leaders must recognize that a huge problem exists, a problem that could end all life as we know it. Suffice it to say that this is not the prevailing attitude. Speaking for my generation, I think our predominant attitude towards nuclear weapons is, not surprisingly, apathy. I doubt I'm speaking about anyone in this room, but I think there is a general attitude that nuclear weapons are a problem of the past. Put in another way, the threat seems entirely abstract. The Cuban Missile Crisis is a well we must constantly draw from to be reminded of the perilous danger that we face and still face. We lucked out 50 years ago. We may not be so lucky next time. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Kingston. Thanks a lot. Let me remind you all about those questions now for part two. If you can be writing them and just circulating them to the end, people will come by to pick them up and give them to me, and it would be great to get them another set in. We have a few to begin with. So let me actually try to, what I sometimes do is combine a few questions so that we can sort of get a number of things out there and let our distinguished guests respond to them. So this one has to do with empathy. And I'm going to fold it into a sort of two-part question. So one is, what if, plausibly, there actually are adversaries that we have that don't want peace for whatever reason? How do we deal with that? And I imagine, Phil, you might want to have some comments on that. Let me put a little wrinkle on that. And what if, in principle, some nuclear, I wouldn't say necessarily even weapons, aspirations might be involved. Kingston, how would you think about sort of just the potential issue of an adversary who, for whatever reason, does not want peace, but potentially has some nuclear capability? No, I wanted you to do that one. Those two, those two angles first.
So I'll start. Sure. Well, obviously, that's why I added the fourth level. That both sides have to accept the legitimacy of the other side. And that one side that doesn't want peace, that wants to make war, it's very hard to have empathy with that side. That's precisely what Cuba finds with the United States and Iran finds with the United States, because they believe that the United States wants to overthrow their governments. So it's very hard for them to empathize with the United States. And therefore, because we're the bigger power, whenever you have asymmetry like this, it behooves the bigger power to convince the more vulnerable that we do truly, the bigger power truly wants empathy and has to take the more extraordinary steps to convince the more vulnerable power. I think the obligation is on the part of the United States in this case. It's not just an abstract question.
Yeah, I would agree on that point. I mean, if, say, for example, Hitler had nuclear weapons, obviously that would have been a very significant problem, he would have had to been confronted, just like he was confronted during World War II. But I think, just to shift gears slightly, and I know Jim and Janet have made this point before, you know, that wasn't the problem during the Cuban Missile Crisis. I mean, you didn't have the Soviet Union or even, you know, Cuba until, you know, we got down toward the fateful day of October 27th, who were looking to start a nuclear war. And, you know, both Phil and I talked about how the absence of empathy had all three sides in effect sort of sleepwalking toward this point. And if you look at the threat posed by Iran today, for example, you know, clearly the United States is far more powerful in just about every relevant category. So, you know, the threat isn't a threat that they are suddenly going to launch an unprovoked strike against the United States. But if we push them far enough, and, you know, we talked about how the current policy at this point is defined much more by pressure, sanctions, covert cyber attack, and it looks like, at least from the Israeli side, assassination. You know, it's hard to convince Iran that the goal here is not to overthrow their government, and how they would react if they are pushed into a corner, you know, is something that I don't think we want to find out.
Can I say one more thing about this? It's about this famous letter from Fidel Castro calling for nuclear war against the United States. I think there's still a lot of misunderstanding about it. So let's try to understand what the situation was. The United States did not know there were nuclear warheads on the island. All of Kennedy's plans were based on an assumption that there were no nuclear warheads on the island. We put a quarantine around Cuba, the United States did, to prevent the nuclear warheads from getting to the island. If they had already gotten to the island, putting a quarantine made no sense at all. What would we be stopping? No, we thought that they didn't have the nuclear weapons. So missiles without weapons, actually, from our perspective, allowed us to act in a somewhat cavalier manner. Castro couldn't believe the United States didn't know. The United States is the smartest, best military, best intelligence. How could the United States not know there were nuclear weapons on the island? So he acted under the assumption that the United States must know. So he writes in the letter, there's likely to be an attack on October 29th, this coming Monday. Our best guess, most likely, it's going to be an air attack. They'll try to take out the missiles. Okay, we'll lose them. That, so be it. But if they launch an invasion, knowing that we have nuclear weapons on the island, they're not going to just launch an invasion. They're going to launch a nuclear attack. They're not suicidal. They're going to strike with nuclear weapons. And therefore, Cuba's going to die. Cuba's finished. Either we're going to get it from a U.S. attack that way, or if you launch an attack, the United States will attack us anyway. We're finished. I'm looking at death. But so it's not that I'm suicidal. I want to go down in flames. I'm going to go down in flames. But if I'm going to go down in flames, I do have a cause, and the cause, he claims, is socialism. And socialism should survive. And the only way it's going to survive, he says, if the Soviet Union survives, so you should strike first. Because there will be a nuclear war if the United States invades. The logic is unassailable that if the United States knew there were nuclear weapons on the island and we were invading, yes, I think we would have used nuclear weapons, but I don't think actually we would have invaded. We were planning to invade. That's what the generals were advocating. But I don't think we would have if we thought there were nuclear weapons on the island. And so his logic was, it wasn't the logic of a madman. It was the logic of someone already knowing that he was going to die. He wasn't suicidal, and that is part of the answer. The leaders we're dealing with, I don't think the Iranian leaders are suicidal. If they launch a nuclear strike, they'll get a nuclear strike back. They are not suicidal. They may send some soldiers into suicidal missions. Of course, we do also. The United States does, that's to say. I don't think the leaders are suicidal, and I think that's another important thing to recognize. So that's one aspect of their rationality.
So we have a question. I want to have an angle on it for both of you. So let's talk about the Turkish missiles. And one point that you made, Phil, was that this was good evidence that Kennedy certainly was flexible in some way. There's a wonderful quote. You can go in and listen to the tapes that Kennedy surreptitiously made during the missile crisis and other meetings later. In which there's the discussion of the Turkish missiles. And Kennedy has a wonderful phrase. Basically, as Phil has mentioned, the Turkish missiles were also not really all that great. I mean, one could talk about them as a bunch of junk. They really weren't, they were very symbolic, but they really weren't fabulous hardware, to be sure. And Kennedy says on the tape, essentially, if we go to war over this junk, his phrase is, quote, this would not be a good war. So he's certainly aware of that. He's trying to push back. And as you said, he's flexible. But it's a secret deal that he demands. The question that we have is, how do you think it would have worked if it was a public deal? How do you think it would have worked if it was a public deal? Now, what I also want to get a sense from both of you is this notion of compromise. Now, from the sensibilities that you have of the political situation, how easy is it for U.S. leaders to publicly compromise on some things? Does it always have to be sotto voce?
There are two problems here with the Turkish missiles. One is that Turkey was a NATO ally, is a NATO ally, was then. And if Kennedy withdrew the missiles from Turkey under an ultimatum from the Soviet Union, he thought that it would destroy the NATO alliance. And it might have. So that while it may have, we may have learned different lessons from the missile crisis, it would have been a different NATO, and he thought that actually Congress, the House, would have impeached him, and the Senate might have removed him from office for essentially backing down to a Soviet ultimatum. Now, why is this important? Part of the importance comes from, again, a lesson relevant for Iran. On September 4th, 1962, in response to charges by senators, Senator Keating and Senator Capehart in particular, Kennedy, who were saying that there were missiles in Cuba, they were getting leaks from some dissident CIA analysts saying there were missiles in Cuba, although the CIA official report said there were none. This is in September of 1962. Kennedy gave a press conference saying there are no missiles in Cuba. And if the Soviet Union put any missiles in Cuba, we will use any and all means to take them out. He drew an absolute zero line in the sand, none. Theodore Sorensen in 1989 at the conference that David and Jim and Janet organized said that had Kennedy believed there were 36 ballistic missiles in Cuba, what he would have said on September 4th is, if they put in more than 50 missiles, then I'll take them out. But because he didn't want war. But he was told there were none, so he said none. Drawing a line in the sand committed him. Had he not drawn the line in the sand, the Turkish missiles might have been easier to give up. But here he had drawn a line in the sand, and he couldn't give up those Turkish missiles. That wouldn't have been
fulfilling his promise. That's the problem. One of the problems we have in Iran, where the Israelis want us to draw a firm red line saying what we'll do, and President Obama is pushing that line as far away as he can. I don't think he's pushed it far enough away.
Sort of a quickie point on that. So I don't know that Kennedy, I mean, it's not like he was dying to draw lines in the sand. Part of the deal, I mean, certainly he believed that this was a safe line, but he was getting unbelievable pressure, domestic pressure, from Congress and so forth. And so there was pressure to draw the line in the sand, and pressure is pressure is pressure, 62, pressure 2012. So.
Is this demanding that President Obama draw a line and say, let me think.
Yeah. Think about that. Anyway, Kingston, you're going to comment.
Well, I would
that.
Just add that, you know, the talking about this issue of compromise and how easy is it for U.S. leaders to compromise. Well, it's almost impossible for U.S. leaders to compromise in an election year, particularly, you know, a few months before an election. And given that election cycles in the United States these days seem to begin the day after the previous election, and everything is so politicized, it is enormous obstacle to the kind of compromises that need to be made. Getting back to this issue of Kennedy and his September 4th statement and how perhaps he may have later regretted that, Phil mentioned that the Israelis are trying to get President Obama to draw some hard and firm red lines in the sand regarding Iran's nuclear program. I mean, one marker that the Obama administration has already laid down is said that containment is not an option, period. And here's a red line that perhaps the Obama administration wanted to take a lesson from Kennedy's later regret. And is this something that perhaps may box the president in when faced with down the road a potential deal with Iran or an Iran that seems to be getting closer to the threshold? You know, does that make war then a necessity when it still may not be the best option?
Yeah, although we also do have Khrushchev during this time, before the missiles are discovered, he makes very explicit statements, public statements, not just in private, to Kennedy, where he says, Soviet Union has no need for bases in Cuba, and therefore won't do any. So at least one of the things I maybe could take from this is that we've got Kennedy, Khrushchev, Obama making statements that maybe, you know, some of us wish they hadn't, but at least in 62, they were able to sort of get beyond that.
Yeah.
So, you know, eating crow is maybe not a bad diet for some leaders in various places.
The Obama administration is dealing with a Senate and House of Representatives, which unanimously agree, you know, that containment should... It is simply not an option. I mean, Iran is one of the few issues where there is significant bipartisan agreement, and you can pass resolutions and sanctions legislation that basically passes 100-0.
So let me pick up on something from that, combining sort of your notion that Phil mentioned about with empathy, you try to put yourself in the position of your adversary. So, you know, there's a lot of good people, good public servants, smart people in Washington that understand lots and lots of things way better than we do. So here's Iran, let's say, looking at two cases that have occurred, and that is, how has the U.S. treated Iraq before 2003 and into 2003, and how has the U.S. treated North Korea? And what might they conclude? And so basically the question is there an understanding, do you think, in the U.S. government of the kind of incentives, actually, that they're creating for proliferation?
That's a great question. You might add Libya to that list as well. Libya giving up via diplomacy its weapons of mass destruction programs in the 2003 timeframe. Libya last year committing flagrant human rights abuses against its own citizens under the mantle of responsibility to protect, the international community assisting the rebels in Libya, and after a few months, Gaddafi is gone. And I believe even that there was a statement from someone high up in the Iranian government, in effect saying, well, maybe Gaddafi ought to have made a different decision in 2003. So yes, I think Iran sees that, and it's a dangerous precedent, although I'd attempt to complicate it slightly by noting that Iran's pursuit, ostensibly at least, of a nuclear weapons capability has not exactly made it safer. Its economy is in ruins thanks to the international sanctions that have been applied to it. Its nuclear program has not given it added prestige or clout in the region. And you know, I would argue that if Iran climbs the enrichment ladder beyond 20%, that makes an attack almost inevitable, for better or for worse, either by Israel or the United States. So I think it kind of goes both ways. Yes, Iran sees that precedent and notes that North Korea has nuclear weapons and didn't get attacked. Libya gave up its WMD programs, and that regime is no more. However, at the same time, Iran's pursuit, or Iran's nuclear program, has raised the probability that it itself will be attacked.
The goal is to sort of have a nuclear weapon, poof, I've got it, rather than the
right.
process
well, that's
of getting
a problem.
A nuclear
yeah,
weapon.
Right. Exactly.
Phil, did you want to come in on that?
No, I think that was a good one.
Okay, great. So, a question on early, when you were talking, Phil, about the lessons that were incorrectly learned from the missile crisis, and then your elucidating some lessons that you would like to be learned from the missile crisis. And the question is, basically, it's a long process to get the right lessons learned. And even now, as we have some people articulating them, it looks like there's lots of examples in Washington, in real world politics, where they're still reading the old edition rather than the newest edition. So the question is, how do you speed up the learning of what you take to be the right lessons from the missile crisis? And on the real political level, Kingston, and the interactions that you've had with Congress and whatever, what do you see as avenues for learning the lessons?
Now, wait a second, Janet. I asked you this question when you were in Washington last week. So I'm going to have you answer the question, because you had a very good answer.
Why don't you steal it and do it?
Well, look, the part of the answer that is that it took us a long time to get the information. So for the first 25 years, what was drummed into our knowledge, our understanding, was a set of lessons that we thought were pretty well understood on the basis of what we knew, and it took a while for people to appreciate that what we knew was wrong. And so, yes, to start with, it takes a long time if you don't know what the reality is. That is part of that gets complicated now because there is so much more secrecy in the United States government. The second is that there's, I think, a greater urgency now than there ever has been because of proliferation. that there's likely to be some catastrophe that no rational person wanted. So I think that it does require the kind of movement that Kingston is talking about, so that it stays on the forefront, that the press is forced to deal with the reality. I've actually been heartened by the way in which the press has reported some of the new findings now on the missile crisis as a result of the 50th anniversary, the repetition of events that now teach us something different. I think Jim and Janet have done an extraordinary job by trying to make some, and Koji as well, making something available to younger people that is not simply old talking heads telling them what to think, but helping people relive the experience in a way that they can understand it, a newer generation. And I think that's what it's about. It's about talking to the next generation, which was your answer was last week. The hope lies that this generation won't get drummed into its head that wrong information with the wrong lessons. It's starting in some ways afresh, and it'll take less time.
Well, I say we need more Jim and Janets, obviously. I think one thing, obviously, is, and Phil just alluded to this, is, and the transmedia project that Jim, Janet, and Koji have unleashed here is vital to us. Vital to this is just trying as much as possible to drill it into people's heads that the original understanding of the missile crisis is flagrantly wrong. And what we now know shows how close we were to nuclear war, and that some of the same errors of judgment that were made in 1962 could very easily be made today. And some of the same dangers that existed then still exist today. One thing I've tried to encourage some of my colleagues who work in the State Department is to have someone of importance there, either the Undersecretary of State for Arms Control and International Security, or even the Secretary of State herself, make a statement on or around the 50th anniversary of the missile crisis, noting its importance. I think it comports with the agenda that the president outlined in Prague. And I know it's a very political time now, and it's difficult to make statements that the other side could politicize and use as a bludgeon against you. But there are ways to do this, to note how the crisis demonstrates that the grave danger posed by nuclear weapons. The president recognizes this danger. He's made some early steps to try and reduce the threat, but there's much more work left to be done. I think that type of message can be made in an apolitical way.
I'm going to have one more question, but I'm going to also ask you guys to be unbelievably perspicacious in your response, and you can follow up with these two wonderful speakers after that. So the theme has been 62 and 2012, so the question will have two parts, 62 and 2012. And the 62 part is basically a brief comment on essentially the after the missile crisis, was this an opportunity for Fidel Castro to really consolidate his reign on Cuba and also to somehow use that to bolster his support in the population? That's the 62 question. The 2012 question, again, sort of talks a little bit about trying to use this as an analogy with Iran. And very briefly, a number of people in the audience have asked to just flesh out a little bit Israel, because all the talk that they're reading about is, U.S. versus Iran, U.S. versus Iran, but Israel is a big player in this. So if you guys can do that in a minute each, your reward is going to be a hug. And if you take more than a minute, I will give you a hug to stop you.
Okay, so Fidel Castro actually thought the Bay of Pigs helped consolidate
his ability to rule over the country. Che Guevara said as much to Richard Goodwin, White House emissary in August of 1961. Guevara thanked Goodwin for the Bay of Pigs because it did give Castro that kind of consolidation. A lot of people were arrested, dissidents, people were left the country, and his standing grew enormously. After the missile crisis, I don't think he needed that anymore. He thought his greatest threat came from the old line Communist Party, and he had actually purged them. He had forced them out of the country in March of 1962. So the missile crisis didn't do that. He got a lot of aid from the Soviet Union in 1963. That was important, I think. In that sense, you could say it helped.
You earned your hug. Kingston.
Well, I'll try and take the Israel issue very quickly. I mean, there's no doubt that Prime Minister Netanyahu and Defense Minister Barak are attempting to push the Obama administration into a corner on Iran. I mean, Israel knows that its ability to degrade Iran's nuclear program, which in recent years has gone significantly underground, is very limited, and it needs the United States military prowess to be able to do what would be necessary to really set it back. So they're trying to get President Obama to articulate firm red lines such that the president would be more compelled to act in the event Iran continues on its current course. And I think, to its credit, the administration has done as best as it could given an election year and given how Israel plays domestically in the United States to retain as much flexibility as possible and not be painted into the kind of corner that Israel might want to push it into.
Can I say one last quick thing? Canada has a role in this. And Canada can play a role of not being a lapdog to the United States, but encourage the United States to do the right thing. It has the freedom to do that, and it has the ability to see both sides much more clearly than the United States can. So you guys could be very important for our peace.
Let me end. Oh, great. Let me end just with one quick thing while Dave is walking up to the podium, and that is you've early on you saw some video of the screen Jim Blight. You've heard from these guys, quite amazing, of this mythical Jim Blight, and who's quite amazing. I happen to agree with all of those things, but the real Jim Blight just showed up. So if we could just, sweetheart, stand up and get recognized. Whoa.
Oh, to be young again. That was terrific. We've all been treated to a wonderful presentation, series of presentations tonight. And let me just say a personal word. Phil, you have the gift for communicating the importance of empathy like just about no one. And I think we all were deeply impressed with the powerful way you phrased the importance of putting yourself in someone else's shoes. I like the way you put it almost as much as the way I like the way Mitch Hedberg puts it. He says it's very important to put yourself in somebody else's shoes before you criticize them, because that way when you criticize them, you have their shoes. quite seriously though, Phil has a reputation for being a terrific teacher, and I think we all saw tonight why that is, and I can't believe it's been 23 years since we first met, because it doesn't seem that long, and I think it doesn't seem that long because I don't see you often enough. So please come back and see us much more often.
Thank you.
Kingston, I've known since October 25th, 2012. Kingston, you've earned the right to come back often, too. I was very impressed, and please do come back and see us early and often. Kingston, by the way, is just back, fresh from a honeymoon in Italy. So.
Like yesterday.
Congratulations, and Janet, a great job, as always. I have a little business to transact before we call it a day. First of all, I'd like to encourage everyone to pick up a copy of the Armageddon letters if you don't have one already. They're available in the lobby for sale, and Jim and Janet can inscribe them for you. And also have a look at the website, www.armageddonletters.com. It really is a tour de force, and you'll be as blown away as I am, I'm sure. Please note the next public event here at the CG campus is on November 2nd. CG will be offering a free public tour of the CG campus. These tours take place the first Friday of every month at 12 noon. If you're interested in a tour of the campus, please meet in the lobby of the building at 12 o'clock. On November 9th, to kick off the CG12 Fall Conference, CG hosts moderator Steve Paikin of The Agenda and Jose Antonio Ocampo of Columbia University's School of International and Public Affairs, formerly with the United Nations and the Government of Colombia. Professor Ocampo will be discussing governance, leadership, and crisis in the global monetary system. This event will start at 7 p.m. On November 29th, Olivier Blanchard presents his discussion, Will the Crisis Ever End? Currently at the International Monetary Fund on leave from MIT, Mr. Blanchard will analyze the forces behind the weak economic recovery and the policies needed to strengthen economic growth and decrease risks. This lecture begins at 5:30 p.m. For more information on upcoming events in the CG Auditorium, please visit the CG website. Thank you again to CG's public events sponsors, 570 News and Wordsworth Books, for their continuing support. Thank you all for coming to the CG campus tonight. We wish you a safe journey home.